Hello students, today we'll start with prose 6. This is Jody's farm. Okay, so who's the author of this? Was the writer of this is Jody's farm? Marjorie Kinnan Rowlands. She was born on August 8, 1896 and died 14 December 1953, and was an American author who lived in rural Florida and wrote novels with rural themes and settings. Her best known work, Darling, about a boy who adopts an orphaned fawn, won a Pulitzer Prize for fiction in 1939 and was later made into a movie of the same name. The book was written long before the concept of young adult fiction, but is now commonly included in teen reading lists. Now, let us begin with the prose. Prose 6, this is Jody's Fawn. Before you read, often instead of rushing to the doctor to treat a small cut or burn, we find quick and effective cures using things available at home. Can you think of some such home remedies? You must have seen your mother or your grandparents giving you tips on some of the problems which you face, some of the healing tips they used to give. Okay, so same we have to over here think of some remedies given in points. So the first one is a cut on your knee. What you try to do, what is the first home remedy you try to apply? You apply turmeric. In Hindi we call it as haldi. Okay, we apply turmeric on our wound so that the bloodshed would stop. Okay, next is a burn on your arm. If you get burned, at that time what you do? You apply borulin. First you apply put that burnt part below the cold running tap water. Okay, and after that you apply an ointment over it. Okay, the first thing what you do is pouring the cold water, chilled cold water, so that you cannot get blisters. And last, a bee sting. Home remedy you can say for bee sting is that a cast iron key. If you must have seen, sometimes your parent or grandparents must have said agar madhumakhi kaati hai, so you can apply that cast iron key so that it would just heal you up. Okay, so in this story also, Jody's fawn has been bitten by a rattlesnake, which is one of the quite poisonous snake. Okay, he quickly kills a doe and uses its heart and liver to draw out the poison. Doe is the female deer. Jody wonders what will happen to the little fawn left without a mother. So Jody is one of the character. The main character is a little boy over here, and he's playing the role of main character. So now let us begin with our first part of this prose. Jody allowed his thoughts to drift back to the fawn. He could not keep it out of his mind. He had held it back in his dreams, in his arms. He slipped from the table and went to his father's bedside. Penny lay at rest. His eyes were open and clear, but the pupils were still dark and dilated. Jody said, "How are you feeling, Pa?" "Just fine, son. Old Death has gone thriving elsewhere." "But wasn't it close, Chief?" "I agree," Penny said. "I'm proud of you, boy. The way you kept your head and did what you needed." So, what happened? Jody could not help but think about the fawn again and again, no matter how much he tried not to hold him in his arms, in his dreams. He finally got up from the table to go to the father's bedside, where his father, Penny, was resting. His eyes were open and seemed clear, but the pupils were still dark and enlarged. Jody asked his father how he was feeling. His father replied that he felt just fine. He felt just cured away. He further added that it was a narrow escape from death which seems to have gone stealing elsewhere. Jody agreed. Penny expressed how proud he was of his son Jody for how he did not lose his temper, he did not lose his hope, he did not lose his being cool and did what was necessary while staying calm. Pa, yes son, Pa, do you recollect the Joe and the Fawn? I can never forget them. The poor Joe saved me, that's certain. Pa, the Fawn may be out there yet. It might be hungry and very scared, said Jody. I suppose so, said Penny. That means Jody's father. Pa, I am a big boy now and don't need to drink milk. Why don't I go and see if I can find the Fawn and bring it here and raise it? Penny lay quiet, staring at the ceiling. Boy, you have got me hemmed in. Hemmed in means caught in a situation where one can't say no. It won't take much to raise it, Pa. It will soon start eating leaves and acorns. You are smarter than boys of your age. We took its mother and it wasn't to blame. Surely, it seems ungrateful to leave it to starve. Son, I can't say no to you. I never thought I'd live to see another day. So he then asked his father, means Jody asked his father, if he still remembered the doe and the fawn. Fawn is the baby animal of doe. To which Penny replied that he can never forget about that poor doe that saved his life. Jody expressed his concern regarding the fawn who might still be out there, hungry, frightened, and as he was separated from his mother, his father agreed. Jody further adds that he can take care of him and he does not need to drink milk as he is a grown-up boy now. So he suggested, he asked his father that if he could go and look out for the fawn. His father asked if Jody wanted to bring the fawn at their place too, which Jody agreed and added that he wanted to raise it too. So as his father looked at the ceiling, he expressed how Jody has put him in a situation where he is unable to say no. He cannot refuse to what Jody was asking for. So Jody tried to convince him further by pointing out that it would not require a lot of efforts to raise it and it will soon grow up to eat leaves and acorns also. So Penny added how Jody was brighter than the boys of his age, other boys of his age. Jody mentioned that it was them who took its mother and now it will suffer because of them, even though it is not to be blamed. His father expressed how ungrateful it would be to let him starve. Penny could not say no to Jody as he had lost all hope of living to see another day. Can I ride back with Millwheel and see if I can find it? Said Jody. Tell your ma, I said, you can go. Jody asked his father if he could ride back with Millwheel. This is the name of a person, Millwheel, to try and find that fawn. So his father agreed. He permitted Jody and told Jody to convey this message to his mom that he, being his father, that Penny has given him the permission to go in search of fawn along with Millwheel. He settled back to the table and sat down. His mother was pouring coffee for everyone. He said, Ma, Pa says I can go bring back the fawn. She held the coffee pot in mid-air. What? fawn. The fawn belonging to the doe will be killed. We use the doe's liver to draw out the poison and save Pa. She gasped, "Well, for pity's sake, Pa says it would be ungrateful to leave it to starve." Doc Wilson said, "That's right, ma'am. Nothing in the world comes quite free. The boy is right and his daddy is right." Melville said, "He can ride back with me. I'll help him find it." She said, down the pot helplessly, "Well, if you'll give it your milk, we have got nothing else to feed it." So, Jody went back to the table in a manner to avoid getting noticed. He told his mother while she was pouring coffee for everyone that his father has given him permission to bring the fawn. On hearing this, she paused and held the coffee pot in the air and asked which fawn Jody was talking about. So Jody informs her that he intends to on bringing the fawn that belonged to the doe they have killed to save his father's life. And how in this part you can understand that how Jody used doe to save his father's life. So he further explained that they used doe's liver to extract poison to save his father. She heaved a high sigh. She said that he can bring him home out of pure compassion. Jody told her that his father thinks it would be ungrateful and unappreciative of them to let the fawn starve. Okay, so Dr. Wilson kept his view forward by agreeing with what Jody and his father said. He thought both of them were right. He further added that there is nothing you can get from the world for free. And we have taken the doe's blood without her permission and it was of free of cost. And because of which father is alive. Penny was alive. Melville volunteered to give Jody a ride and help him find the fawn. On hearing all this, Jody's mother felt helpless as she sat down. Even though she was not in favor of it, she knew they were right and thus agreed. If Jody gave the fawn his share of milk as they had nothing else to feed, as they had nothing else to get on or have some extra purchasing to feed the fawn separately. Melville said, "Come on boy, we have got to get riding." Ma Baxter asked anxiously, "You'll not be gone long." Jody said, "I'll be back before dinner for sure." Melville mounted his horse and pulled Jody up behind him. He said to Melville, "Do you think the fawn's still there? Will you help me find him?" We'll find him if he's alive." "How you know it's a he?" The spots were all in a line on a doe fawn. Pa says the spots are very every which way. So over here, as soon as his mother agreed, Melville asked Jody to come along and said that they needed to go. Jody's mother Baxter quite uneasily asked for reassurance that he will not be gone for long time. Jody replied that he would be back before dinner. Melville climbed his horse and helped Jody sit behind him. Jody asked Melville if he thinks the fawn would still be there and if he will help Jody in finding him. Melville assured Jody that they would find the fawn if it was alive. And however, he asked Jody how he knew that fawn is male. Jody told Melville that he is sure because his spots were all in line, in a proper, the spots were lined. And Penny had told Jody earlier that a doe fawn or a female deer has spots in different directions.